this is deTraci, and this time I think we've got the sound working right. If not, please let me know. And thanks, everybody. I was so delighted with the response to my little video on the systems that I bought in Egypt recently. It just delighted me. I had no idea so many people would watch it. And thank you so much. It definitely is a bright spot in these unusual days where we're all spending so much more time on our own and in our houses. However, there were problems with the audio on that, and I was not able to fix that. If anyone knows how one can re-edit a Facebook Live video, please let me know, because I would love to salvage that audio and make it a little bit more accessible to more people. But much to my shock, I realized that I did not do all of the systems and items that I brought from Egypt. And I definitely didn't want to miss out on talking about this one because it's a really, really special one. I think you'll agree. This is the missing sistrum. This is a beautiful handmade sistrum made in Egypt. It's all made out of copper, though as I show it to you, I'm seeing that it looks a little brassy on video, but it's actually a beautiful, lovely copper shade. And as many of you may know, copper was especially sacred to the goddess Hathor. And we visited Hathor's temple and really had a wonderful connection with her there. One of the things that happened to me there was that our wonderful leader, Normandy Ellis, knew that this sycamore fig tree, which grows at the temple site, is said to be very good for eczema. And so we got some of the juice from that tree and put it on some spots that I've been having trouble with. And I have to say, it seems to have worked. And my skin is doing much, much better because of it. But I hate to even discuss the tree because it looks like it's just hanging on. And I wouldn't have taken any juice from it if I'd had a moment. But it was, you know, like, oh, here she is. Quick, take the juice. And then they, you know, scrape the tree and the juice comes out this plain white color and then almost immediately turns to a golden tone, almost like a turmeric color. And then a little while later, it goes to this beautiful red color. And so I put it on the spots that bother me most, and it seems to be working. So I'm very grateful to that temple and to Hathor, and to we were at the little temple of Isis there at Dendera, and it was a really beautiful experience. So getting back to this little sistrum, as you can see, it's the double-faced style, but it's a little bit different because instead of having more of the Hathor head where you have the hair and all of that, as I have on this other big metal sistrum that I showed you last time, it's just the face. So it's a little bit different. And this particular image is really the hieroglyph that is used to indicate the face or concerning and so on. And there's an interesting little story about this particular hieroglyph I'm going to show you. Hopefully this will show up. I haven't done papers with these videos yet. Well, I don't think it's showing up too well, but as you can see, this is how you would see it in an inscription. And I'm told that I remember, you know, a few years back when President Obama visited Egypt, he actually saw this on one of the temple walls and said, hey, that looks like me. And I guess there is a little bit of a resemblance. So I can't help it. I'm starting to think of this as my Obama sistrum. So maybe we can shake things up in that way. So it's a beautiful little sound. And if you look closely here, you can see that there's little stars all around the edges. And also on the forehead, you have an ankh offset with two of the eyes of Horus or eyes of Ra or eyes of Isis, however you want to see that. So this is a really beautiful one. And one thing that's really interesting to me right now is if you look on, you can look this up online if you like, they're finding that copper is very antibacterial and antiviral. And there's a call for metal, you know, like handrails and things being used in hospitals and old people's homes, if they make it with a layer of copper on it, it may actually cut down on the transmission of some very nasty stuff, including the coronavirus. So I'm not telling you to rely on copper to protect you from the coronavirus. What protects you from the coronavirus right now is social distancing, washing your hands, and unfortunately staying in as much isolation as possible. But it's an interesting thing for the future that maybe copper will be regarded as more important. And so I'm very fond of this. This was made by a nephew of our guide, Emil, and I really, really love it. And it is just a beautiful, beautiful little sistrum. And I also received, this was actually purchased for a temple by some of Ananda Ray's priestesses. And this is a beautiful Was scepter from the same artisan. And the Was scepter is best known as being held by the god Ptah. And you'll often see him, you know, clutching it. It'll be, you know, clutched in front of him. And what you have is the combination of part of the Jed column, which we associate with Osiris and which is said to mean stability. And you have the Ankh, of course, of life. And then the Was scepter part itself, which usually is seen as meaning dominion or power. Now, the interesting thing is there's a lot of more variations on the Was scepter than I realized. And there's a very good site that contains some information on joanlansbury.com. Has a good collection of imagery of the Was scepter. I've always thought of it as the set-headed scepter, and many Egyptologists agree because that's what it looks like most closely to me. But apparently there's a lot of dissent on whether that really is true. There's one person that believes that it actually is indicating some sort of dinosaur head. And of course, there's all sorts of conspiracy theories or alternate history theories about that. But for a while, it was seen as a bird head, a hoopoe head. But some of the examples have a lot more detail in here, and it's pretty clear that it's not a bird, that it is some sort of beast. And I tend to take the set interpretation because a giant one of these was found in one of the temples of Set, and in the oases, it was also associated with Set too. So I think when another god is holding it, it's, you know, kind of showing dominion over the powers of chaos, but also showing that that power can still energize what they want to do as well. So you've got a grip on it. You've got a grip on it when you're holding this scepter. Now, one thing I was surprised about is that an Egyptologist that I just adore, Dr. Bob Breyer, he sees it as a ram's head. And I'm trying to see it as a ram's head, but I just can't. And furthermore, he says that the tip of it represents the cloven hoof of a ram. And I'm just, as much as I love his stuff, I'm just not quite seeing that. For one thing, I have here the Egyptian hieroglyph for the word night. And the this particular hieroglyph, as you can see, ends in the same kind of tip as the Was scepter. And that is the hieroglyph for night, which is a night sky with a lightning bolt coming down from it. So I don't think it was a cloven hoof, but it's interesting. And by the way, now that I've disparaged Bob Breyer, I'm going to make up for it by pointing out that there's a wonderful course online right now that he did for the Great Courses, which is called Decoding Egyptian Hieroglyphs. And I've got to say that this is a really excellent course. If you go to the Great Courses Plus or the Great Courses website, you can get a free trial. And on the Great Courses Plus, you can use your free trial to look at all of their many courses, but you can take the Egyptian hieroglyph one. And that even includes a PDF, a 278-page PDF book, all on Egyptian hieroglyphs, including some exercises and answers, and it's really fun. There's 24 courses, so 24 lessons in it, so it'll keep you busy for a while, and you can learn some things about Egyptian hieroglyphs. So although I disagree with him on the Was Scepter, he's a great teacher, and he's also the author of Ancient Egyptian Magic, which was a really fantastic book that came out quite a while back now, but it was one of the first places that really put together a lot of ancient Egyptian magical practices based on newer archaeology and research. And so I recommend that one too. So anyway, I just wanted to catch up with some of these things that I brought home from Egypt and talk a little bit about them. And as I say, you know, it's interesting that copper may be antibacterial and antiviral. So I give you that bit of information, but again, be safe. And I'm going to be going out in a minute. And one of the most important things you can do is wear a mask. So I just want to know that, you know, I know that it's been hard lately because a lot of people don't have masks. We don't want to take them away from our medical workers, but, you know, so just use whatever you have and do the best you can, but wear your mask. Okay, bye-bye.